Have you ever wondered what a septic system from 1976 looks like? Well, today we have ourselves a fun one. There's no records. We don't know what's here. We get to play the fun game of, what do they have going on? Hopefully it's nothing too crazy. So let's go ahead into the backyard and see what we're working with.
All right, at first glance, we see that we have ourselves a manhole riser, which is that little fella right there. And we have ourselves a 4-inch PVC cleanout.
Typically, this is not what you would see on a 1976 house, especially for this area. More commonly, you would see a 6-inch cast iron cleanout. Maybe you'd have to dig up the lid, but this one's got a riser, so that means somebody's touched this at some point. This is good news for us because this means that we're not gonna have to work as hard. The really interesting thing is that somebody put that 4-inch PVC cleanout. So we gotta figure out, why are you here and what's going on inside of there? A lot of times those types of cleanouts are gonna be indicating a distribution box. So once we pop it open, we should be able to see fairly quickly, is it a distribution box or is it something weird? So let's open up the riser, open that up and see what we find.
We're gonna take our handy dandy hook and we're gonna go ahead and shove that right underneath. Pop it loose, and then we can use the handle to actually get it off. I like to pop them loose because sometimes they can get stuck in, oh, and the handle's broken. Excellent. Not what we want to see, but I guess that is what we're working with. When we look inside, we can see that we have ourselves a PVC baffle. I mean, somebody's touched this at some point, but this riser looks kind of gross. We can see all sorts of dirt working its way on the inside.
Wondering, how does all that dirt get into the riser? Well, when you have a concrete riser like this, it just sits right on top. And every time it rains, especially in sandy climates like this, all of that sand and dirt will work its way into the tank. This is a very old style of tank because it has that concrete cutout. It's square. We don't use the squares anymore. We don't really use square lids anymore because square lids can fall into square holes and that can lead to a lot of problems. More commonly nowadays, you're gonna see a circle lid on a circle hole. Circles don't fall into circle holes. You wanna make sure that you have a nice watertight riser. That's so that way surface water doesn't get into your septic system. If dirt is getting into the riser, that means water's also getting into the riser because the only way that that dirt can get there is if water is taking it there. These systems are designed to only take a certain volume of water per day. This is a 3-bedroom house, meaning it's only designed for 450 gallons of water per 24-hour cycle. If you have more than that going through there, you do run the risk of overloading your entire system, which can cause premature failure. It's very important to make sure that you have a watertight riser on your septic system. It's more important when you have an older system or a tight lot because it can make your repairs much more expensive and difficult. Repairing something on a tight lot usually indicates that it's going to be a much more expensive project because there's less room to work with and your availability of good soil is also limited. If you have a bad perk test, now you're going to be getting a very expensive system. Nobody wants an expensive system. We have the riser open. We can see the outlet baffle. We'll have to grab our mirror and flashlight in a minute and see what the rest of the inside of this tank looks like. But now we need to open up that white pipe and see, is that our distribution box?
We're gonna go ahead and take our channel locks and just pop this bad boy right on off. You'll usually see these on distribution boxes so that we can see what's going on inside of them. Because sometimes you can actually have failures and you might have to dig up everything in order to figure out what's going on. But by having this, you can figure out what's going on much faster without having to tear up the entire yard.
When we're looking inside of the septic tank, we can actually see a little bit of root intrusion coming in through where the lids are. With this particular style of lid, basically it's gonna be one large rectangle that goes from one end to the other end, and they're pretty big and heavy. So that's probably why they actually cut the hole into it so that we could actually get to it without having to lift the entire lid off of the tank. Not the best way to have it, but it is what it is with these older systems. There is no real rule for a busted up lid. When you have something like this, it's best to make sure that you get everything done proper so that we don't have any root intrusion, water intrusion, soil intrusion, things like that. The downside is this is a really, really old system. So what that means is if you do replace it, it might be more cost effective to replace the tank itself. And at this time period, it probably is a bit much for what they need to do. Probably just let it go until it eventually fails. The next thing we have to do is test the absorption system. That's gonna be the drain fields with the distribution box. How we do that is we take a hose just like this one and we introduce it into the system and we're gonna run what's called a hydraulic load. A hydraulic load test needs to be conducted anytime you're evaluating an absorption system, especially when you have a vacant house, just to make sure that everything's flowing the way that it's supposed to flow. Keep in mind that we have an older system, so we need to make sure that we put some water through it to make sure everything's working. Generally, our state guidance is you'd put half of the peak design flow into the system. Pennsylvania, you do the entire thing. So what does that mean? If we have a 450 gallon design spec, you gotta put at least 225 into the system. But in PA, you would do the entire 450 to make sure that everything's functional. I think that 450 is a little bit much, especially if you try to put it in an hour, but that's the way the state recommends it.
So the very next step is to find the absorption system. Now, it is so humid today that with that very little bit of effort, I'm already sweating like a pig. How are we gonna find the absorption system, you might be wondering?
Well, it's really easy. We have cameras for that.
No, like I'm actually gonna be using a camera for this. Our cameras have a little radio on it, and because we have access to that distribution box, it makes the most sense just to toss the camera through those pipes, see where it goes, and then I should be able to find these things in about 5 seconds. As we're running the camera through, we're also gonna be looking at the pipes to make sure that they're open and water's flowing, there's nothing crazy going on inside of the system. One of the most common issues we find are collapses in pipes, obstructions in pipes, even roots in pipes. Part of the hydraulic load test is to make sure that water is getting to the pits. In this particular circumstance, we found that there are two dry wells on this system, or seepage pits. What is that? These are the old school method of dealing with wastewater. Essentially, it's a large cylinder in the ground, and they're gonna dry stack cinder block around it, and then they're gonna put stone. It's a big void where once you put 10 gallons in, that 10 gallons will kind of work its way through the dry stack cinder block, the stone, and into the surrounding soil. It's basically like a fat version of a drain field.
We don't really see these all that much anymore. They were definitely much older style, and they usually kind of were phased out somewhere in the mid to early 80s.
A drain field's far more cost-effective and safer.
With dry wells, you do run the risk of, if you run something heavy over it, you could potentially collapse the roof and go into it.
I've had a person where they were installing a pool and they had a crane go over their absorption system. It squished the entire lid of the dry well, and it took them 7 hours to get this crane out of the pit.
Fortunately, everybody was okay, but there are some circumstances where you might not be okay if you fall into it.
Nowadays, when pits are used, a lot of them are required to be filled with stone. An existing one like this, there's no requirement from the state, but the moment you go to repair something, then they're gonna make you do it the right way. This particular system looks like it's in pretty good shape. Even though it's from 1976, it's still functional. And how we can check that is we run water into it. Now, we did notice that one of the pipes between the distribution box and one of the pits was crushed. It turns out that they actually had an above ground pool over top of the piping system. Remember, water is heavy. So for every gallon of water is roughly 8 pounds of weight. They had this massive pool on top of their pipe, and of course it crushed the pipe.
And all they gotta do is just replace that portion of pipe, and then they're back in business.
The water levels in these pits look fine. When you're going to measure how much life is left in the system, you have to take your baseline. So for this particular example, we're just gonna say they're 10 foot in total diameter, or total depth. So if you've got 10 foot of total depth, and let's just say you have 5 foot of empty space, that means you've got 50% of the life left in it. Once you do the hydraulic load test, you're gonna see, does that water level rise? Does it stay the same? What does it do based on how much water you put in there?
So let's say that we have 5/10 of the system still working, and we end up putting in 300 gallons of water, and we notice that we lose a foot. Well, what you're supposed to do is continue adding water until you reach an equilibrium. Is that practical? No, but the purpose of this is to see where is the water absorbing, especially for a vacant home. If that happens, it does take a lot longer. So let's just say that we have our 5/10. We put a couple hundred gallons of water in, it goes up a foot. What we're supposed to do is measure to see how long it takes for it to drop back down. So we come back the following day, measure it again. If it's 6 out of 10 with water, then what we're supposed to do is fill it again. And let's just say it gets to 7. You keep doing this process over the course of multiple days until you finally figure out it's either gonna back up completely or it's gonna work correctly.
For real estate, this is not super practical, but it's the most important way to do it in order to figure out if this system is actually functional. So if you get a weird dry well doing some funky things, it's a good idea to keep on testing it the correct way.
That way you don't buy a system that's basically falling apart.
This type of system is very common for this age of a home in the area that we're in, and it's working. Doesn't mean it'll last forever, but doesn't mean you have to replace it.
There are some less than scrupulous home inspectors and septic contractors out there that if you have 50% of the pit gone, they will just make you replace the whole thing. I don't think that's accurate. I don't think that's the correct way of doing it, because if it still has 50% of its life left in it, it may be ugly, but it still works. And that's the most important part.
If you're doing an inspection for a real estate transaction in Maryland, remember that thing's regulated. You have a very specific rule set and guideline book that tells you exactly what is and is not acceptable.
So if you're ever concerned about whatever the person said, maybe you're on the selling side and they say your absorption system's failing, have them give you the rule book or search the rule book. It's public information. You can find it very easily. And then you can ask, which of these am I in? And then they should be able very clearly to say, hey, page 34, number 3, or something to that effect to tell you what's going on.
If you gained any value out of this, if you thought this was interesting, let me know below. Leave your comment. Do you want me to start doing more videos like this on the regular? Anywho, I have videos posted every day on the world of wells, septic, homeownership, DIY projects, even some basic stuff that I do in my own personal life to save a little bit of money here, a little bit there, and I want to share it with you. So if you enjoy this, hit that like button, hit subscribe, and I look forward to talking to you guys tomorrow.